this. It's one of the great sporting duels. A game of extreme emotions, exhilarating skill, and unbearable tension. It pushes body and mind to the limit. Scientific advances have reinvented the game. From the design of the racket, to the way players move, and the way they train. Science tells you where to hit the ball, how to get to the ball more quickly, and how to keep your mind focused. Technology has made tennis faster, but is this new power game still true to the spirit of tennis? The Albert Hall in London. It's home to one of the great tennis entertainments, the Honda Challenge. The tournament reunites legends like John McEnroe, winner of 7 Grand Slam titles, former Wimbledon champion Pat Cash, Boris Becker, the German who stormed to victory at Wimbledon aged only 17, the great women's champion Martina Navratilova, winner of 18 Grand Slams, the elegant Henri Leconte of France, and the clown prince of tennis, Mansour Bahrami. These players can afford to relax a little nowadays. They've reached the top of their profession and have the silverware to prove it. But the desire to win remains strong, and the Honda Challenge is an opportunity to rekindle old rivalries. You won't find John McEnroe slacking on the senior circuit.
I don't play as hard as I ever did, but I play hard. Harder than the average 27-year-old.
Nor has Boris Becker lost his competitive streak.
I've been beating most of the guys in the former circuit, and it would be awful to lose to him now.
These former champions were part of a tennis revolution. They were witnesses to the great technological leap from wood to graphite rackets, which created a new breed of player and a new style of tennis. In the imposing setting of London's Vanderbilt Tennis Club, Australian Pat Cash is reunited with the faithful old friend he last used against John McEnroe in 1984.
I was one of the last guys to use wood rackets. I didn't want to let it go.
Rackets were made of wood for the first 100 years of lawn tennis. As Cash is rediscovering, wood called for a very particular style of tennis.
I find if you hit it right perfectly, it goes great. But if you're on the run or something like that and you have to a slight miss hit around the edge, it doesn't go anywhere, does it?
Yeah.
I also noticed the volleys. It's slow, isn't it? I mean, it's slow because the balance, I suppose, is very head heavy and it's just hard to maneuver quickly.
Yeah,
sure. I don't know how we did the reflex volleys. Yeah. I quite enjoy it for fun, but I wouldn't like to dive around the net and hit a lot of passing shots. But no, thank you.
Wood rackets were heavy and encouraged a long, flowing swing. The style was elegant and did produce some beautiful tennis. The shape of the racket was constantly evolving. It started with a tilted head, then an oval, then the classic teardrop, and ended with this. As Cash demonstrates, a wooden racket produced a slower serve than today because it was heavier to lift. It took strong muscles to swing the racket faster and create more power.
I don't think I hit one in, did I?
In the Wimbledon Lawn Tennis Museum, Peter Maxton can chart a revolution in racket technology.
This racket, the Dunlop Mexply, was the really state-of-the-art of wooden racket manufacture in the late 1960s, early 70s.
This classic racket was 27 inches long and 9 inches wide, dimensions so universally accepted that you could measure a net height with them. A racket like this was made by a craftsman. It combined a perfect mix of ash, beech and hickory, which was lovingly steamed and molded into shape. But but wooden rackets were still fragile, as Mansour Bahrami remembers.
I used to, you know, before play in one match, I could break 3-4 rackets hitting it on the ground while I was playing. And, you know, they were heavy, they were like rackets for like 500 grams.
These limitations were seized upon by American engineer turned inventor Howard Head. He'd taken up tennis in his 50s, but was so wild at the game that his friends called him Scatterball. He decided to make the game easier for himself by the simple act of making the racket bigger.
As you can see, the Maxply fits comfortably inside. And this is about 25-30% larger than the Maxply head. He realized that anything that would make the game easier to play would be a great advantage. That would attract more people into the game. And by having a larger headed racket, you could mistime the ball slightly, or you could make a mistake, but the ball still went back over the net. And also for older players, they could their reflexes are getting a bit slower. It was an ideal racket for them.
Howard Head was not the first person to think of a larger racket, but he was the first to successfully market it. He used aluminium instead of wood because it could withstand the higher string tension needed on a bigger frame. But aluminium was soon overtaken by lighter, stronger materials used in space technology, such as graphite. Mass production replaced craft, and wood was on its way out. Stars like Romania's Ilie Năstase, McEnroe and Cash remain divided over the benefits of the new racket.
I think I play my best tennis with a wooden racket. And so Laver and McEnroe and other guys, they play unbelievable with this racket and board. But again, it's much easier to play with the new rackets. And just to learn, probably it's easier. Because, you know, when you look, maybe it's not so easy to start with a wooden racket.
I think it's taken away some of the artistry of the game, so I'm a dinosaur in this regard. I believe that what we had before was something that was, it's disappointing that it's not there now.
I was one of the last guys to use wood rackets. I didn't want to let it go. Because the power game, I've gone to a more powerful racket. I've gone from a small wood racket 15 years later, or 20 years later, to the big-headed racket. I'm slowing down, I need the extra help, that's all.
So what is the extra help, and how does the bigger racket make such a difference? The Prince Classic intrigued physicist Howard Brody of the University of Pennsylvania. You might call him a racket scientist.
One day, I happened to notice the new big racket being played with. This was the original Prince Classic racket. I asked the teaching pro, why was this racket better? The pro had no idea. So I decided, hey, here's a nice field to investigate.
The tennis court has become Brody's outdoor laboratory, where he can show why the wide-bodied racket makes tennis easier. Using a rod with weights to mimic a racket, Brody shows that with the weights close together, it spins uncontrollably. As he shifts the mass further apart, the make-believe racket spins less.
This means that if you go to a racket with a wider head, it's going to have more stability against twisting when you hit the ball off axis.
So it's science which confirms the benefits of the bigger racket. In part two, we look at how this racket created a power game and how the stars of tomorrow have adapted to it. Each winter, the world's top under-19 players gather in Miami, Florida for the Orange Bowl International Tennis Championship. These stars of the future have grown up using modern rackets, and they've developed a hard-hitting style all of their own. The strokes they play are new. Their grips have changed, and their body movements are different. They have to be faster and stronger, because tennis today is all about power. But where does the power come from in the game of tennis? One source is from the energy generated when the ball hits the strings. Physicist Howard Brody explains.
When the ball hits the strings, two things happen. The ball compresses and the strings deform. The strings then snap back, the ball snaps back, and out it goes.
The bigger racket has approximately 7 feet, 2 meters more string length than its wooden predecessor. It creates a bigger rebound and propels the ball even faster. Strings are a very personal thing for players. They choose tensions that suit their style of tennis. For example, looser strings give more power, but less control. But technology has been unable to improve on tradition. No one has yet invented a superior material to natural gut made from cow's intestines.
Gut is more elastic than synthetics, particularly as you go to higher tension. Gut retains its elasticity at high tension. When you take a nylon or some other synthetic and you stretch it, it starts out being very elastic. But as the tension gets higher and higher, its elasticity goes away. So you don't get a good hit from the ball.
However, gut is expensive and only used by the top players. A specific tension creates a musical note. Professionals become so attuned to their strings that they can hear when they've lost tension. Power in tennis is also determined by exactly where the ball hits the strings. Once again, the wider and longer the racket head, the better your chances of a sweet hit.
There are really three separate sweet spots, three spots where it feels good when you hit the ball. One spot is called the center of percussion. It is where, when the ball hits, the shock or jar to your hand is minimized.
The second sweet spot is where there is least racket vibration after the impact. Scientists call it the node. A piece of card attached to a racket amplifies the different vibrations at the tip, the throat, and the node.
All you hear is that nice ping of the strings.
The third sweet spot is where you get maximum power, at the throat.
If I drop the ball on the tip of the racket, it doesn't bounce very well. If I drop it at the center of the head of the racket, it bounces somewhat better. If I drop it near the throat, it bounces considerably better. Why is this?
The throat is also the balance point of the racket, where least energy is lost from racket twist and recoil.
To get maximum power, you want the ball to have maximum energy going out. Therefore, you want to hit very close to the balance point. The further from the balance point the ball hits, the less energy the ball ends up with.
Another source of power is generated by the player. By pushing off the ground, they transfer energy all the way up the body to the racket.